He walked into the living room and turned on the table light. Nothing happened. And he thought, well, it's a burned out light. And he went to get another bulb and he took the old one out, put the new one in and turned the switch. Nothing happened. He thought, well, maybe it's the cord. So he went to Lowe's and got him a new cord, came home, and it was only then that he recognized that the cord was not plugged in. Got to be plugged into the power if a lamp fulfills its purpose. And it's the same with us, by the way. You and I must be plugged into the power of God if we are to become and if we are to be what we are capable of becoming and being in the Lord Jesus Christ. Must always be plugged in to the power. And that's what I want to examine with you today. And we're going to be studying from the first chapter of Paul's letter to the Ephesians. So I'd like to invite you to open your Bibles to this chapter. Some of the key words are going to appear on the screen this morning, but our study is going to emphasize this part of the Apostle Paul's letter to the church in Ephesus. Now, Paul's letters usually begin in about the same way. He announces first who he is, who the writer is. That was the custom in ancient times. Now we usually sign our letters at the end. They sign them at the beginning. And as Paul begins the letter to the Ephesians, the first thing that he does is give us a description of who they are. Now, notice the reading beginning in verse 1. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, to the saints who are in Ephesus and faithful in Christ Jesus. First, he says they are saints. Now, saint means to be set apart, but it also means to be dedicated. And he says that the Christians at Ephesus are saints. That is, they are dedicated to the purposes of God. In the Bible, there are often things that are called holy things, and there are people who are called holy people. It means that they're set apart, that they're dedicated to the service of God. And that's precisely what a saint is, a holy person. Not holy because of our own accomplishments, but holy because of who we have become in Jesus Christ. He says they are saints, and then they are faithful in Christ Jesus. Well, if they're faithful in Christ, that means they're in Christ. So they've obeyed the gospel. They have been baptized into Jesus, and now they're seeking to live the new life. And they are the faithful in Christ Jesus. Now, in describing the Ephesian Christians, I want to come down to verse 15 and notice two other things that Paul says about them. He tells us that after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints, I do not cease to give thanks for you. Paul recognized that the Ephesians were a great blessing to his life. He had planted the church at Ephesus. He had been responsible for preaching the gospel there. And he looked back upon the beginning and growth of the church as he writes this letter, and he is grateful for what they have become in the Lord Jesus. And he says, first, there is your faith. You exemplify great faith in the Savior. that you have come to know and the one you follow, your people of faith. Christians always need to be people of great faith. That is, those who are able to step beyond what they can see as their own power and depend upon the power of God by faith. I heard a story of the guy that fell off a cliff. And as he fell over the edge, there was a branch growing out from the cliff, and he grabbed hold of it to save his life. And there he is, hanging between life and death. And he began to cry out. He said, "Is there anyone up there?" And a voice said, "Yes." He said, "Can you help me?" And the voice said, "Yes, but..." And he said, "But what?" And the voice said, "But are you a person of faith?" And he said, "Yes." And the voice said, "Let go." He thought about that a second and he said, "Is there anyone else up there?" We are people who, in the name of Christ, will let go of our comfort areas and make a step out on our faith. And that's the way the Ephesians were. And the second thing is, they had love for all the saints. We are loved by God. He loves the church. Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. We are the church, and we love God, and we love Christ, and we love each other. Here's a description of the Ephesians. What a wonderful church this was at Ephesus. Now, the second thing that Paul does in this opening chapter of this letter is that he gives us a picture of the privileges of the Ephesians and the privileges that belong to all who will know and follow Christ. And notice quickly with me what he says about that. Beginning in verse 3, Ephesians chapter 1 says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in Christ." In Christ, there are all spiritual blessings. That just says, if all spiritual blessings are in Christ, there aren't any outside of him. But he says to these Christians, and therefore he says to us, that if we are in Christ, these spiritual blessings belong to us as well. He enumerates 7 of those blessings. Not that these are all that are in the list, but 7 is a word of completion. And these 7 represent all of the spiritual things with which God blesses us. And here's the first. In verse 4, he said he has chosen us in him, in Christ, before the foundation of the world. That just means that we have heard the call of the gospel, we have responded to it, and he's added us to those who are chosen for eternal life. Being chosen of God, biblically, does not mean that he looks across this audience and he picks you out individually and says, you will be the chosen, and somebody else he picks out and says, you will not be the chosen. God has ordained from eternity that there would be in Christ a group of people, and that people would be chosen. But he always leaves us with the responsibility of making the right choices. And we can choose to be in Christ or out of Christ, but if we choose to be in him, then we are among the chosen. Number 2, he says, having predestined us to the adoption of sons. Predestined means pre, before, destined. It is to map out before a thing happens. Just as God chose to allow those in Christ to be called the chosen. He said those in Christ have been determined in my mind from eternity to be my children, not individually, but collectively. The predestined are those who have made the right choice in regard to responding to Christ. Then down in verse 7, in him, that is in Christ, we have redemption. Redemption is the freedom from the slavery of sin made possible by the price of the blood of Christ. Now we're free when we're in him. In the same verse, he says, the forgiveness of sins. When we're redeemed and when we're in Christ, God blots out our sin and declares that we are righteous, declares that we are innocent. He forgives our sins. And then number 5, down in verse 9, he made known to us the mystery of his will. Let me tell you something that is quite wonderful. If you are a child of God, you know what's in the heart of God. He said he has made known to us the mystery, that is, that which was covered, but is now revealed fully in Jesus Christ, the mystery of his will. If we ask ourselves, in the mind of Paul, what is the mystery of God's will that now has been made known, that the Ephesians know and that all Christians know? Just read a little further. And he tells us precisely what it is. He's made known to us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in himself, that, here it is, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times, that's the time in which we live, that in the dispensation of the fullness of time, now watch, he might gather together in one all things in Christ, whether they be or both, which are in heaven and on earth in him. We read those verses and we may think, I still don't understand fully what he's saying. Let me explain it this way. When you were in your sin, you were separated from God. The world is fallen. So the world is separated from God. God has purposed to reconcile the world to himself. And Jesus has come. He's come down from heaven, lived upon the earth, died here, was buried and was raised and glorified. And his purpose is to bring heaven and earth together, to reconcile a lost world to God. And that's the purpose of God. That's what God is out to do. And you know that when you're in Christ. You know the very mind of God. But there's something else here. Paul says in verse 11, in him also, that's in Christ, we have obtained an inheritance. An inheritance belongs to children of parents, doesn't it? And God is our Father, and he has made us his children, and therefore the heirs of all that heaven has to offer. He has given us an inheritance. And then the last thing that Paul says about spiritual gifts, this is number 7, down in verse 13, he says, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. Now, the Holy Spirit of promise is found in Acts 2 and verse 38, where when on the beginning day of the church, believers ask what to do to be right with God. And they were told to repent and to be baptized. Peter says in that verse, every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. That is the promised Holy Spirit. And here he says, you were sealed by this promised Holy Spirit. What does seal mean? If a king puts his seal on a document, it means that document's genuine. And God has put his seal on us. We are really the children of God. It's not fanciful thinking. We really are the children of God because through the gospel, God has made us his heirs. He has sealed us with the Holy Spirit. We're real. But a sealing may also mean safety. When Jesus was buried in that borrowed tomb, you may remember that his enemies were fearful that his disciples might come and steal Jesus' body and proclaim him as risen. So they wanted a guard set, and they set the guard and they sealed the tomb. What's that mean? They wanted to be sure the body stayed inside. How little they knew, because it wouldn't be long until that stone would be rolled away, Jesus would be raised, and they would be witnesses of what happened. But the purpose of their sealing was to bring assurance. It didn't work out too well for them, did it? But when you and I are sealed by the promised Holy Spirit, that means that we are under the protection and the safety shield of God. Satan cannot come upon your blind side and steal you away from Christ without your permission. And that's the key to it all, without your permission. Because God comes in our weakness to supply his strength. We're sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. There's one other thing about a sealing. In the Old Testament, in the story of Jeremiah, one of God's prophets, he bought a piece of land. And when it was completed, both Jeremiah and the seller put their seal on it. What does the seal on the receipt mean? This is a finished deal. And that's the way it is with us. God seals us. We're his. We really are. And we're under his safety. And the deal has been done. Christ has died, has been raised. And we have responded to him through the gospel. And we have been sealed. Thus Paul speaks of the privilege of the saints. He first identified them, then he talked about their privileges. And then notice particularly the verses that were read a little while ago, beginning in verse 15. Here, Paul is praying a prayer for the Ephesians. I am really astounded by Paul's prayer life. Paul prayed about everything, it seems, and prayed for nearly everybody. He begins nearly all of his letters, and he wrote about half of the New Testament, with, I'm praying for you. But he doesn't use that as we sometimes do. We may say, I'm praying for you, and I'll see you down the road. Paul said, I'm praying for you, and then he specified what he was praying. And that's what he does here. He says to the Ephesians, therefore I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints, do not cease to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers. All right, Paul, you prayed for us. What are you praying? Verse 17. That the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, now this is what I want God to do, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give to you a spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him. God has revealed to us what we can know about Him. Paul was praying for the Ephesians that they might fully know what God has revealed. And not only what God has revealed about Himself, but Paul wants them to know God better and better. I have an idea that that's the same prayer he would pray for us. He wants them to have the full knowledge of God. And then, to expand upon the thought, there are three specific things that Paul prays. I want you to increase in the knowledge of God. I want you to have wisdom in your response to God. And this is how it comes about. He said, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know, here's number one, that you may know what is the hope. Of your calling. Now, did they know anything about hope? Oh, yes, I'm sure they did. But having heard the call to the gospel, Paul says, I'm praying that you may grow in the reality of the fact that you are now people of hope. The world has no hope, but in Christ, we have hope for the future. And our hope reaches even into heaven itself because our hope is that we will live eternally with God. Paul wants the Ephesians to more fully grasp the reality of their hope. Number two, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints? Did they have an inheritance? Paul already talked about that in their privileges. Yes, they were the heirs of God. Paul wants them to know how rich they are. What I'm trying to say to you here is we know the blessings of being in Christ, but we need to come to a fuller appreciation of how rich we are spiritually. God has done so much for us. And it must break his heart when we hear of the good things that he has done and we sort of have a ho-hum attitude about it all. We ought to be excited about it seems to me. Paul said, I want you to know more fully the hope of your calling, and I want you to know more about the inheritance that God has for all of us. Number three, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power? Now, that verse is a power-packed verse. Let me emphasize three words that he uses. He says, I want you to know the greatness of God's power, his dynamite. The word in the New Testament is dunamis. I want you to know his power. And then he says, I want you to know the working of his mighty. And then the English Bible uses the word power again. But in reality, there are three words here, and the three words carry the idea of power, might, and strength. And that's all available to us. And God is asking us to plug in to the power. He illustrates his power in respect to Christ in the latter part of this chapter. He says God showed this power that is his in Christ when, number one, he raised him from the dead. Well, that'd take a lot of power, wouldn't it, to raise the dead? He raised him from the dead, and he exalted him to his own right hand in the heavenly realm. So he raised him and exalted him. That's God's power. And then God honored him by making him the head of the church. That's the way Ephesians chapter 1 closes. Paul said, I want you to see more clearly the hope of your calling. I want you to appreciate more fully the riches of your inheritance. And I want you to live within the power of God, the God who can raise the dead, who can glorify his son, who can make him the head of the church. I want you to plug in to the power that's available to you. There was a guy who went to the hardware store and he bought a chainsaw. He brought it back the next day, and he looked for the manager. When he found him, he said, this chainsaw doesn't do what you promised it would do. The manager said, what's the problem? He said, you told me that with this chainsaw, I could cut 40 trees a day, and I did the very best that I could do, and I only cut 5. And the manager said, well, let's see what's wrong. He said, let's start it. And so he got everything ready, pulled the cord, and the thing came alive with power. And the manager said, I really don't see anything wrong with it. And the buyer said, what's that noise? Now, I know that that went over the heads of our deacons, but the rest of you got it. You got to be plugged into the power. And so today, let me ask you, what are your struggles? Where do you need the power of God? If you're not a Christian, you need God's power, which is the gospel, to save. You need to respond to the gospel. But in your personal life, you may be having struggles on your job. You may be having struggles with your finances. There may be problems that you have as husbands and wives or parents with children. It may be that you have some difficulty with a relative or a friend. You may feel that you need help in living successfully the new life in Christ. You may be struggling with health issues. How are you going to deal with life as it is? And I want to say, by the power of the living God, all of us can meet head on whatever it is that we're facing, and we will be the ultimate victor. You may be thinking, well, that sounds good, but one of my relatives was sick and we prayed for him and he didn't get better. He died. See, what we must remember is that sometimes when we pray, God delivers us from the issues of life. He may deliver us from our illness or from the problem that we have in our family, the problem we have on the job. He may deliver us from them. Sometimes, though, he delivers us through them. The problem may still be there, but he will work with us through those. They may never be solved the way we want them to be solved, but he will strengthen us for the way. What he's asking of us is, plug into the power. Now, I find it interesting that Paul's exhortation is more about what is done for us than what we do. You know, that's the way it always is in our relationship with God. It's more about what God has done than it is about what we do. And yet, God wants us to be active in this process. So he says, you plug into the power, you open yourself to my power, which is available to you, and it's the same power that raised Jesus from the dead. And he said, I will do for you what you could never do for yourself. You do what you can, you plug into my power. And by my power, I will do for you what you cannot do for yourself. So plug into the power. What is your need today? If you're still out of Christ, the power of the gospel can bring you to salvation. I would that it was possible for me to become a Christian for others, but I can't. That's a decision that every one of us must make for himself or herself. But I can plead, and I can pray, and I can try to get people out of Christ to think about where they are in their relationship with God. The power of God in the gospel is there for you and for me to respond to. Is that what you need to do? If you are struggling with a problem, can the church help you with that? We can if we know something about it. This would be a great opportunity for us to share with each other what is in regard to our needs. If you have a need you'd like to share with the church today, and let us together with you pray to God, whose power can work in whatever we're facing. But we must plug in to the power.
Let us rise up and fill with the labor of the Lord.